Good afternoon. My name is Alex Schneider. I'm a field application engineer working at Root Electronic, and today I'm the moderator of this session about USB-C and what to keep in mind about certification. Please let me welcome you all to the meeting. Still some people are coming in, but everyone who is already here, of course, welcome to this meeting. This is one of four sessions, and I want to make you aware very briefly of the upcoming events that we are doing together with Eurofins in the coming few weeks, actually. So the 10th of June, we will have a session about USB 3 again, but then about the power delivery protocol. On June 24th, we will talk about wireless power and the G qualification that needs to be done there. And our last session will be at the 8th of July, where we talk about signal integrity, impedance matching, PCBs, and also a lot of debugging of high-speed interfaces. So a lot of interesting topics, I would think. And if you didn't do so yet, I invite you, of course, to register for those as well. Not all of them already sent out as an invite to you. During the session, you are muted. That does not mean that you cannot speak, at least not with a microphone, but you can type. We have a Q&A session available. If you look at the right side of your screen, you have the ability there to write in the Q&A or in some other form of letters, depending on your language settings. And then you can ask all questions that pop up in your mind, and we try our best to answer them during this session. Possibly we cannot answer directly, or maybe we are running out of time. Then, of course, we will come back to you and do this on a later time by a phone call or an email or whatever is the best solution for that case. So we're going to have a webinar. I believe it's an hour, not 30 minutes, like I said here. But it will be recorded, as you might already heard when I pressed the record button. You got, if everything is all right, at least a message that we are recording the session. And afterwards, it will be available on our YouTube channel for you to review, send to a colleague, or well, do whatever you like with it. Please allow for about a week to get it uploaded to our YouTube channel. Then I would like to introduce the speakers of this webinar. If our next slides will pop up at least. No slides for that, okay. Remco van der Grient will start off about the USB-C connector. And the sessions after that will be done by Pascal Berton, who will talk about the certification area there. So from that point of view, I will give the word to Remco. Good luck, and to the audience, if you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the Q&A session of your screen. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex, for the introduction. Yes, my name is Remco van der Rindt. I'm a field application engineer for the electromechanical parts of Root Electronic. And for this session of today, I will start with you about the USB connector and a lot of other things. Like you see here, a little bit of brief introduction of USB, of course, the electrical and mechanical performance. Then we are looking to the USB connector itself. And at the last time, also the processability of that connector, how you need to solder and that sort of things. And after that, Pascal will start with you about also the qualification and testing for all the things around USB. What I already said, brief introduction, brief history about USB. I think a lot of people know that USB 1.0 was coming around the 20th century, around 96. Then 2 years later already, they're coming up, the 1998 USB 1.1. You see already a big increase of bit rate on that way. It was starting with 1.5 megabits, then 12 megabits, and then you see 2.0 already have a big big advantage with the bit rate. It calls also the high USB high speed protocol. 480 Mbit. And if we look into now, we already are going to USB 3.1, and you see 10 gigabit. And also before that, we see a power delivery protocol. It was up to 100 watts, and it's, now it's already a version 2.0, again with 100 watt, and now also with a Type-C. So you see a lot of different sort of things in this schematic, but I think a lot of people already knows brief history of USB. It's only to let the people know how it is. If we are looking to the USB Type-C, what we already got with the power delivery 2.0, also about the upcoming 2 weeks, about 2 weeks, we also discuss about power delivery, what already Alex told, also together with Eurofins. But if we look into that, you see a little bit of basics. On the left picture, you see here, and I will put on my laser pointer, you see here a side view of a notebook. And you see a lot of connections in here, USB, HDMI, Ethernet, model jack, power. It's a little bit, it's big populated on the side of that small side of a notebook. And you see with the USB Type-C, there was is a possibility now that you can have, like you see here on the right, one that you with one connector, you can do a lot of things. And it's only with one small connector for the USB-C. You can go up to for 10 gigabits of data rate, alternative modes with Thunderbolt 3, HDMI, like what you see here, display ports, that sort of things, but also networking for with Ethernet model jacks, also the power delivery for 100 watts. And the nice thing about this USB, it's reversible. A lot of, all the other USB connectors are not reversible, but this one, yes, you have. So that's also a big advantage of this smaller connector. And you see here that the mating cycles are also evaluated to 10K mating cycles for the USB-C, because not every USB connector has it. For your information, the 2.0 was only 1,500 mating cycles. And for 3.0 off, it was be 5K for some parts. And now we see that we have 10K mating cycles. This everything, this is also that the TI listed, TID listed, and TID listed will means that design of the connector is really following the USBIF organization design. So it's also good to have that, and that's easier for your information to go on the testing, like Eurofins is needing, that it is also really following the design of USBIF. So that's really the basic of the Type-C. If you look into this, USB-C, a lot of people see this as a new protocol, but it's not a new protocol, it's only a new connector. It's visible as it's a new connector, but over that USB-C connector, you can use a lot of different sort of protocols. And you can have, of course, it's a different cable. USB-C, it's a different sort of connector. It's much smaller than the USB-A and the USB-B. And the easier way is that you can go ahead with source and sync. And Pascal also going to talk about a little bit later on about communication, that sort of things. So that's the Type-C basics on that way. If that's not good to each other with the source and sync, then you can a lot of horrible things like you see burning. And that's also what you hear a lot of things later on that the good connection must be there, and if it's not there, then you could have a lot of things. So be aware of a good connection and a good cable you're going to use. Also there it is, you have a lot of copies from Asia parts, and it's not always that it, Asia is not okay, but you see a lot of things what you can find that AliExpress sort of websites, that it's not the right cable. So be aware of that also. And this is, I think, what we can really let you see. USB-C is a one for all. With USB-C, you can also transport USB 2.0 protocol signals up to 3.1 or 3.x then. But also HDMI, I already told, also power, also DisplayPort, Thunderbolt, and that sort of things. Also audio with a lot of sideband uses versions, but I'll let you see later on So yeah, it's really a small connector, but it really replaces a lot of things, what you already saw on the side of that notebook or earlier. Now we're going to have a more deeper look into the electrical and mechanical performance of this connector. How must it be? All this performance and all this data is also following the USB IF design, so also following for the TID listed, and a lot of parts from us, our side, and also USB-C types are TID listed, and you can find it on the USB organization website. Like you see here, looking to the electrical parts, you see the contact resistance. It must be, it's really put in the USB IF documents, and it's really following that. The delta contact resistance after the 10K mating cycles must be 10 milliohms, sorry, after the initial of 30 milliohm maximum you have there, especially for the VBUS, and the ground is 30 milliohm, and the other pins for data and that sort of thing, the maximum of 50 milliohms is okay. Insulation resistance, it's around 100 mega ohm. Also the dielectric withstanding for the plastic is 100 mega ohm. And here below you see the current rating. Yeah, more if you're looking to a comparison for the C types, also to the A and B types, but also the micro B, you see that for the C, you get the 5 amp 20 watt, 20 volt 400 watt for the highest version of power delivery. You get that the for the A1, A4, A9, and A12, that you have a total of 5 amps. For that, so you can really reach that 100 watts on that way. You see here normally 5 volt rating, yes, but if you go to the power delivery protocol, then the 20 volts for the C also for our part. Looking to the mechanical part, you see a lot of different things. You see what I said, mating cycles, 10K, the micro B has also 10K, but it's especially because of the more also source for the more power source you had, also with a lot of the devices you can see. How this is measured, it's with the same speed, you have 200 cycles, so hour that you need to test it, and then you must meet that mating cycle of 1500 up to 10K for the C and a micro B. For insertion force, you see here that the A, the B, and the micro B must be lower than 35 Newton. For the C, it's 5 Newton to 8 Newton. Also with an speed, it's put into the ISB, USB IF documentation. So you really, as a manufacturer, needs to test it on that way, so that we can really go ahead and that really can see, okay, this is okay. And the USB organization also tested our part to get a TID listed, and they said, okay, it's meet these requirements at the minimum of that way. Extraction force is a little bit different. You see here also the difference in it, the mate before mating cycles. So a really new connector for the C, you see that the force is in between 8 and 20 Newton. And after 1000 is specified, and after the maximum of 10K is also specified. It's a little bit different than the rest. After that, it was a little bit, by USB 2.0 and 3.0, it was only, especially the AB and micro B, sorry, it is only after the maximum of mating cycles. And you see here, this is the same speed like as the insertion force. It's a little bit more background on it. Now, if you are going to look to the USB type C plug and receptacle, you see here the pinout for it. And of course, you see the different colors, and you see here the matching colors on it. So the A6 and A7 and B6 and B7 are USB 2.0 signal pairs. You see here the USB 3.x signal pairs, receiving and transmitter. And because it's reversible, you see a difference on it in the upper row and the lower row on it. And you see here a little bit different with the plug. You see you have two different versions. You have a full pin out version like you see here. Then it's the same pin layout as the receptacle, but you also see that the below has only 10 pins instead of 12 pins, and that's because not everybody wants to use a multiplexer for the USB 2.0 signals, and then you have two different versions. And you don't, if you don't use the USB 2.0 multiplexer for to cross that signal pairs, then you can't use a full pinout version. Then you need the 2020 version, and then the orientation of the cable is measured on that way, that you see that the D plus or D minus is on the okay way, and you can really check it with the CC and the VCon how the orientation of the cable will be. So that's why you really see, must I make a connection with the lower one or with the top of the upper one row. That's why how the pinning is for the full pin version. Of course, we have only at this moment, you see also the full pin version for USB type 2.0, because you have also USB-C 2.0s. And normally you only have to use these highlighted pins on that way. Again, for the same for the plug and the receptacle, plug also with a 22 pins version, you only have to connect these pins with the right versions to make a connection on 2.0. But of course, with the power delivery protocol, you need also to go for the CC channels and that sort of things. These are the pinnings for that way. You have also sideband uses, what I already told you earlier. Sideband uses Thunderbolt 3, display port, what you see on the left side, and with HDMI and that sort of things. And you see here that the receptacle has a sideband use 1 and 2, and over that channel, you must make a sort of a protocol. You can use a protocol that's also designed by the USB organization, that it's, you can communicate on that way, that you are going using the USB-C also, like a display port, like a HDMI port or something like that. So then it's really good to know that you are going to use that A8 or B8 versions for the receptacle, and for the plug, you see A5 and B5. Sorry. You see also that we have a CC channel, or in the terms of the protocol, the configuration channel. It detects a lot of things. It detects if there is really a connection or not. It detects the cable orientation together with the plug on the VCon, that it's okay or not. It manages also the source and sinks connection. Later on also, Pascal already told, is going to be talk a little bit more about it. It manages also the power delivery protocol on that way. And it manages also the alternative modes in combination with the SBU pins, like I told earlier. If you look into the higher currents, and it's higher than 1.25 amps, the CC also organize first that there is a connection, and then it becomes more a VCon, a pin, and then you can really have a powered circuit, and that it also communicates also on that way with the integrated circuit in the EMARC cables and devices, that it could be more higher than that 5-volt 3 amps, and then you have really need to have EMARC cable or higher. Also, there is a little bit small introduction from Bob Pascal's side, so that's why I'm going a little bit further on that way. From our customer side, we received some questions about layouting about the USB-C connector, because it's a dense connector, and that connector is really a connector. How must I say it? It's really hard to lay out on the PCB way, but you need to keep some things in mind. And of course, the more parts you have, the higher the thing, the difficult the routing is on that way. You see here a filter board we designed for USB 3.1C, especially to look if everything is on EMI side or EMC side on a good way. You see the common mode chokes, the TVS diodes, and also the power delivery part of these, of the power delivery for these ones up to 100 watts. And on this way, I want to let you see how things can go ahead on that way. If we look into the layout type of the USB-C, I already told you, see it is high dense, and sometimes it's really hard to make a good routing, and sometimes you need vias. And vias is not always, of course, especially with the higher speed signals for the USB 3.0x, it's really not preferable to have vias, but sometimes it's you must do it on that way. And then it's good to know how you can place it and how many vias. How many vias is really hard to say for us because it's a lot of things you need to keep in mind. But a thumb of rule is that you say, okay, around 2 or 3 is max in your one differential pair versions, of course, but you still need to take care of it that, that the differential pair has the same length and that sort of things to avoid delays and other influence like capacitive influence and something like that. So how to place vias? Yeah, of course, as short as possible to the signal side on that way. As you see here also, as short as possible sometimes to avoid it, but yeah, it's hard to say how you must route it and that sort of things, but try to make it short to it, and also to keep in mind sometimes that you place vias around around traces like this you see here, that to make it right that you have not the fully that is not going to work as an RF filter or something like that. So you must keep it that good in mind. You see here a crazy thing about it, and some maybe that's why I want to point it out. Normally you want to avoid in the differential pair that the via must be put inside of the differential pair, but this is for a USB 2.0 signal, and this one was okay to avoid to make it really narrow to each other and to put a via in between. But it's good to know that this could be a possibility to have it in between a differential pair version that way. So here you have still no delay because it's only for USB 2.0 and you have no delays and changes in your big changes in your signal way on that way. But how you must keep in mind with the via, what's the must I take a full via on the full thickness of your PCB, or must I use blind vias? Of course, there's also depending on how you must route and that sort of things. I can let you see something like that. If I really again zoom it in, there are several options, of course. You have a full plated or through hole or via from the full thickness of the PCB, and especially for make signals from one side to the other layer and it's not the full length of the full thickness of your PCB, then you can take can have a closer look to have a blind or a buried via. It's depending, of course. This is of course buried via that's inside of it. This of course could be blind vias with micro via stops and that sort of things. There are several options, of course, that you need to take in mind. Of course, later on, I will let you see a little bit more about the signal path and what you can do about it. But of course, to use blind vias or buried vias, it costs a lot of extra cost for your production side. What I understood from our sister company, Wood Electronics CBT, that are producing bare PCBs in that way, a blind via costs around 25 to 40% more if you have a lot of, a couple of vias in it to place that one more than standard via. A buried via is around 25 to 60%, but you have another option. You have also back drilled vias. Back drilled via is a little bit different. You make it full plated through hole. As to mention, it is also back drilling, so it's okay. One part of the via is going to be drilled away again with a bigger drill than the diameter of the hole, of course. And I'll let you see now later on how this is going to work. Here you see a signal pad, and from this side it's a full plated through hole, and you want to go from the top layer to the second layer, and this third layer is not going to work. What I already told you, can also say, okay, we make a via to here, but it costs a lot of things extra. But there's also another way, what I said, back drilling of control depth drilling. That's the other term you can use for it. And then you can see what I told, there's going to be a bigger drill, real this part of Copper Way. So you have a lot of you have less influences from for on EMI wise side, because this part could be used as an antenna, and of course can this way, with this sort of antenna, you can have a lot of interference on your signal, and that's of course what you don't want. And of course capacitance influence you have here also. That's also everything you want to try to avoid, to really make a good signal transfer and also a good signal integrity on that way. And that's also what we're going to discuss at the latest webinar of this series with, together with Eurofins. But for this info, you can have a go ahead on that way with back drilling. What you said here, okay, you're going to drill away, and then you see it like here, and then you only have this path, and the rest of this path, of course, is gone. Only what you need to keep in mind is that there are not be a big, there are not be going to be traces around that via. Of course, if I go back again a little bit, if you have traces like here and connected here also, and you are going to back drill, of course, then it doesn't work. So it really must go the through hole. You want to beat it on the cheapest way. They first with the production, they make a play the through hole. The second path must go here. So we're back drilling this way. And then without any traces around this, you don't harm the traces on that way. So then you can go ahead also with this back drilling or control depth drilling way of producing. And this is only what price difference is around 10% more than with the plated through hole placement of a full length of the PCB. So if we look into the magnetic way, and I'll go into a little bit go ahead because otherwise I'm going out of time. Routing of the magnetics, first side on transmission side, place there your common mode chokes on that way. The receiving side, the TVS diodes to get also there, of course, to avoid a lot of ESD problems like that, of course. So that's what you really keep in mind. And of course, let's go a little bit more in depth next webinar. Also, of course, with power delivery more in focus, but also with common mode chokes and that sort of things. If we look into that filtering board, what I'll let you see also a lot of people are thinking, there are a lot of ways to build up and to stake up a good way for your USB-C version. You see here, especially for the transmission side, you see here how big the traces are, how thick the traces are with this build up with first the solder resist with the dielectric constant of 3.5. You see here, of course, the first copper thickness, then FFO material for the pre-pack, then again layer, and then FFO4, and then you go ahead and you have the total build-up of your PCB. And of course, we must always keep in mind that the dielectric constant of the different sort of material can have different sort of influences on the way how traces or how the signal going to transfer over your PCB. But these are not that big gaps for dielectric constant, so this is really a good way. So keep that in mind, that that could be a setup for that way. But of course, this is a guideline. Everything is going to be changed if your traces of your PCB going a little bit wider, or maybe just a little bit smaller, that this also have influences on the way how it's set up. But you have a little bit of guideline how we did it. Now more processability. You see here our USB-C receptacle. It's a hybrid version. You see two THR or through hole reflow pins and SMT versions to make a good mechanical stable solution for that. But it's, of course, that's a combination. What I said, through all reflow pins with or pin and base pins, of course, and SMT, that makes a little bit different to and the high dense, it makes it a little bit harder to make a right good production way. What I want to let you see here with this you see the base printing and the stencil. You see your stencil layout. You see also these are the holes for the stencil to produce from your side. You see here for the SMT pins, but also for the THR pins. Parts for in the stencils, so you have the right paste on it. But The pasta deposit is not okay if you're looking to that weight. So the volume of the paste is not okay. So you see here that the also at the bottom view there that we have you have a small ring over the annular ring of the PCB that you put some small rings of paste on it. That you could be also with a paste jet printer on that way. Put it on so you have a right volume of paste to make a good solderability on it. Now I want to let you see how it's going to do if you're not going to do it on that way. You really leave the bottom stencil away. And you see here that you see that you have without defects, and you see here also some shade parts where you have defects that is not good soldered. And especially for the higher heat pins, for especially for the USB 3.x pins, it's really good that you have the right solderability. Everything is really good, good way soldered, that you have really the good transport of your signal through the whole PCB and the whole pins on that way. Of course, you can also do an hand soldering, especially for the THR pins, but that's not good because it's an uncontrolled version. We also make some X-rays from the two top versions, and you can see without the effects, you see really that is really the black. These are the pins for the THR. You see that's really filled up good with paste. It's really soldered in a good way to the whole PCB. And you do it on the other way without the bottom stencil. You see that there could be some. Yeah, that white shade you see here, that is not good soldered on that way, and you could be have some problems with the transportation of your signal, the high speed signals on that way. This is for the receptacle, and for the plug it's a little bit different because the plug have also a top view and a bottom view because you have a double row side of your pins, and it must be put over your PCB on it. So you have on top and bottom also pins, and your PCB must be in between the pins. That's the solution how USB organization designed it, and that's also the way how you must do it on that way. And that could be a little bit hard because it really must be not placed, but it's more that the PCB slides in between the pins, and that makes it a little bit harder to make a good way. That's also a little bit from our side. If you're looking to the top side, that the page what you see here, this the red is the patch of the layout, and the blue is the stencil apertures. You see that the page is not going to start really at the beginning out of the edge of the PCB. So if you are sliding the plug from this side to the upper side, that is really not scraping off the paste in beginning. That's why we are starting a little bit out of the beginning of the paste. That's our guideline. So that's everything is going to be okay. You see here also reduce the width of the stencil opening. That width is 0.3 millimeters and the opening must be around 0.2 millimeters, sorry. And the opening of the stencil must be shifted around 33% backwards. So that everything is going to be solved on a good way. That is what you see here, sorry. The bottom side is to reduce the stencil opening in the same bit like the original pad. The bottom side could be a little bit better. And the relation to the original pad must be around 4% less than the rest of you have what you see here. If you do it on that way, you see here that the top view and bottom view is really solved on a good way. There's a processability of the receptacle and the plug, but small things what we want to keep that you must keep in mind is if we look into solder paste, you have different sort of grain sizes, and the grain size, of course, the bigger the grain size is, it's a little bit harder, especially for that THR pins to go that the grains could go into the hole and it doesn't affect the placement of the pins inside of that hole. That's why we're saying, and that's why a lot of people are saying also, a lot of production sites are saying, for that part of the USB-C, if you have a hybrid version, use a type 5 grain size of solder paste. And you see here that the Yeah, the grains are not cannot be bigger than 30 micrometers, and minimum of 80% must be between 25 and 10 micrometers. Then the balls that doesn't affect the placement of the pin inside of the hole. If we look into squeeze, you must have two cycles that is going to front and backwards. Now it's a little bit going to be faster than my speed. And you see here that the squeeze speed must be around 20 millimeters per second. The force must be a minimum of 7 kilograms or 70 newton, and the angle must be around 45 degrees, that everything's going to be really on a good way into the aperture of the stencil. If everything is okay, then the solubility must be on the good way, like that you see in the last slides. A small conclusion from my side is that you see we have the USB-C is a good connector with a lot of options, but you have a lot of tight specification, especially if you look into the electrical and mechanical way, but also placing and PCB routing of the USB connector is a little bit different than we are used to be with the USB-A and USB-B connectors, also like the micro and the mini USB. So to keep a lot of things in mind with soldering of the connectors, to have more attention from the production side, but keep that in mind that a lot of things are really a little bit harder to do than on a normal way. So keep that in mind, and we have here some guidelines to how you can use it. So this is my part of the presentation. I think we can now go ahead to Pascal, Alex.
Thank you very much, Remco. Very interesting. Pascal, I have given you a presenter right, so you should be able to share your screen. Perfect. I already got some questions for Remco, but we will answer those at the end of the session. And if you have anything to ask, then yeah, please do and use our Q&A session on your screen. Pascal, good luck.
You hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we hear you. Yes,
all right. We hear you. Yeah. All right, good. All right, thanks. Thanks, Remco. And thank you for following my presentation on Type-C. And I'm talking a little bit about the USB-IF compliance. So what I will talk about is how to migrate from legacy connectors to Type-C, cover some Type-C compliance, go over the Type-C compliance testing, also a little bit on power delivery, even though I'm not going to cover full power delivery because this will bring us too far. And Type-C is also having some compliance testing on radio frequency interference, and I will briefly discuss this as well. Okay, so first, who am I? I'm Pascal Berten, and I'm working the Eurofins already 20 years. I'm doing mainly USB, but not only that. Did a lot of certification for more than 1,000 products. Beside that, I'm mainly focusing on serial data like HDMI, DisplayPort, SATA, and these kind of things. That I'm also developing some fixtures and help customers debug their problems. Now, who's Eurofins? Eurofins is the first USB-IF certification lab in the world and still the only one in the EMEA region. Besides certification, we also do pre-certification, we do debugging. We have all kind of equipment in-house. Typically, certification goes in, it's done within 2 weeks, so we're very flexible in testing and also give consultancy on all kind of parts for testing on USB. So what's new with the Type-C? We already had, of course, we covered over something by Remco. Of course, you can flip the cable, it's more robust, all these kind of things. Another item is, of course, it can do more power, up to 100 watts, more data rates, up to 40 gigabit if you take USB-4 into account. So beside the USB regular protocol, there's also other protocols supporting the Type-C. Like DisplayPort, HDMI. There's also the audio support, regular analog audio, and there are also some features like authentications and firmware updates that can be done here. Now, let me talk a little bit, let me get this window here, right, about how to migrate to type, if you have a regular, if you want to switch from regular USB, so the legacy connector to type C. Now, for USB 2 device, this can be considered be straightforward. You just have to change your PCB to a type C connector that Remco already discussed a little bit. And you will have to do, you have to make a pull down resistor of 5K1 to ground on both CC1 and CC2. This will make your device a type C. This is only for USB 2. For a host, this becomes rather more complicated because a host compared to regular USB, 5V was always on VBUS. Now with type C, it's only should be available from the moment there's an RD detected. So you will have to make some kind of a detection on VBUS in order to switch on VBUS before doing that. Now, a host not have a pull down, but has a pull up, and this can be done with a 56 kilo ohm resistor. Depending on the value here you have, you can have, so if you use 65 kilo ohm, you have the regular USB 2. If you want to have more currents, if you say you might host support more, you can change this to 22K, then you can do 1.5 amps. And if you do 10K, you will have, can support up to 3 amps. So then the device is allowed to take 3 amps. So this is how you can switch to migrate from legacy to type C. Now, besides all this, there's also quite a lot of, so the type C specification has also a lot of timings you have to keep into account. There's a consideration you have to make. Therefore, most products actually use the type C controller actually to swap from handle all these kind of things, because it's a cold circuit, as I told you before, you cannot have VBUS always available. So DRP, so if you have, if your product like a mobile phone can be sourced and a sync, so you can give VBUS and you can take VBUS, it's becoming complicated in order to do this. So that's why many vendors will use a type C controller actually to handle type C. So you may get rid of it if you have a regular USB 2 device to just pull down resistors on CC lines, but from the moment you have a host, DRP, or even you have super speed, you will also have to change the data path. Then I would say use the type C controller. Also not forget power delivery can have higher voltages. So you may consider putting in a type C controller only also for protection, because they will protect the your device from higher voltages. So let's jump to the compliance part. So quickly, USBIF. USBIF is USB.org. They are a non-profit organization. They organize, so they own all the specifications. They are free available. They have some workshops. They have working groups. So here you can go in order to become a member. You can join these work groups. You can go to the workshops and these kinds. Why you need to get certified, this assures a certain quality of your product. If you want to use the logos, you will have to you need to be certified. Some vendors require this to have a certified product. If you make something, they say maybe you need to certify it. Other programs like Apple CarPlay actually require to get certified in order to get Apple CarPlay approved. And it's at least something you can I mean, we also see some vendors have dispute between if you get certified, you at least have something in your hand. Now with USBF compliance is a big portion. It's exists out of electrical testing, protocol testing, link layer, connector testing, all kind of things. So there's a lot of different specification, electrical, cable, interoperability testing is also a subset. So their power delivery is a complete different story again. So they have all these kind of testing separate, and interoperability again here, and then Type-C also. So, and also depending on the speed you have, you have USB 2, USB 3.2, number 4 coming along. All these kind of things have also the separate kind of test procedure and test specs. Here is, for example, a test matrix from for USB 3 products. Depending on what kind of product you have, the host device, end product silicon, all these kind of things will make the testing different. Type C in power delivery even make it more make the test matrix even more big, and you will need to test all these kind of things as well on top of the regular data testing on the data pairs. But now you also have to do the power delivery and the Type C interoperability protocol testing. Now the one of the things that's new, obviously new, it's already a few years, but for especially when Type C power delivery and higher data rates are involved, it is for us, in order to do the testing, we need to know the details of the product, because Type C have you can have different RP values, you can have these, so the testing depends on the product you have. So in order to do certification, when the registration, we need this vendor information file in order to proceed the testing. Also, the equipment we use actually rely on these VIF files, we call that, to run the test. So based on the VIF, we know what to test and the equipment as well. So there are a lot of automation tests, and these are relying on these things. With legacy devices, there's not much to fill out. From Type C, you will have to fill out more. When power delivery gets involved, you certainly will need all these details. So presentation is focused on Type C. So what is the Type C functional testing? So this is one portion of the testing if you implement Type C. So there's a Type C specification with all these parameters, the timings, the voltage levels, all these kind of things. And from this, they make the Type C functional testing. Type C functional testing is for all products that have a Type C port. It's the same as the source DRP. They will all need to go through these tests. And the equipment is like they measure the current and the voltages on the PC lines, on the SBU lines, and they measure the timings between that. Now, one of the equipment that is required or mandatory to pass is the LaCroix here. LaCroix, you need to pass these tests. And in addition, one of those, the ELISIS or the DRL, need to pass these tests. We see a lot of the results between the vendors are not really always correlated. That's why we need to at least test with two. So we, and with the Eurofins, we use the LaCroix and the ELISIS solution to run these tests. Most of the tests correlate, but it's not always the same. Also, some test cases are covered only by LaCroix and some only by the ELISIS solution. So we need to go through these tests. Here's an example of the sync. Well, LaCroix has all these traces available when running the test. It's actually pushing, but so you're connecting the device, push the button, and hopefully you get all green flags, and it's a pass. If it's not a pass, you can analyze all these traces and see what's going on. Again, so the testing, like you see here, it's really depending on what you fill out in the VIF file. The VIF file will select what kind of test cases are applicable and which one are not. The same test for ELISIS. So same requirements. For example, this test is only with ELISIS done. It's not done with LaCroix, so there are some. Besides the Type C functional testing, there's also Type C source testing. As the word says, it's only for source testing, but it's based on several specifications. It's based on the Type C, it's in the power delivery, the USB 3.2 and the USB 2. And with that, they made the source test capabilities. Type C source testing for USBF compliance is done with the Quadramax. It's only applicable for source and DRP and not applicable for things. You can also do with this Quadramax, you can also do testing cables. Voltage drops, all these kind of things you can do. It's not only doing for Type C, it's actually also doing the whole power delivery stuff that I'm not covering in this presentation, but it can do that. You can also do some manual testing, like do a load. It's a current source, so you can do some debugging with this with load. Note also that the Quadramax takes the voltage drop over the cables you use into account. This is with high currents, a few milliohms has a big effect on the result. So these values should be taken into account. It has 4 ports, so it will test 4 ports at the same time. And all the adjacent ports are also observed during the test. So it verifies the, go to the next slide. So it verifies the voltage and the current on all ports that are connected, and it will go through the automated test. There's an example here. The Quadramax is doing the load, and it measures the current and the voltage during all this process. For type C only, it will check what RP value it has. So depending on the RP value, he will do the certain load that is required for do the testing. So the voltages should stay between 475 and 5.5. There should be no bigger droop, so that's no effect on the adjacent port than 330 millivolts. The increase of the voltage should be monotonically, so it should go up and not a little bit down somewhere down the road. There's also a source inrush test, so they will switch on 10 microfarad on VBUS to see if it can handle this. So for example, this example here, so the Quadramax switch on this 10 microfarad, and this, for example, fails here because for some reason they switch on over current protection because the current is too high, and there you have this droop. So this is a fail because it actually should stay 5-volt. Good things to know to keep in mind with type C. If you have these kind of car chargers, you make sure that so testing is also done under different input voltages. So normally this is 12 volt, but in the car it's not always 12 volt. It can be 13 or 11 volts. So all these tests are done under different voltages. If the old battery charging specification is supported, we also need to test these. Again, take the voltage drop of the cables into account when doing these kind of testing. They are crucial. I mean, you only have a small margin for your VBUS, and if you don't take this into account, yeah, you will have invalid results. Also know that you have to do the testing and you have to flip the cable and do all testing again. So the testing takes quite a long of time. This is not only for, this is for all the testing done, almost everything needs to be but also if you have a SYNC device like a mobile phone, testing is also done with a dead battery because the conditions can be different. When a mobile device has a dead battery, the behavior can be different. I'm not going to cover anything too much about USB to electrical, but just note that there is also type C fixes. I mean, if you do type C measurement, you need to fix, you have to do so, use your facial test fixtures like here. They're available on fixtures.com. They of course use all wood connectors because they're the good connectors, so, and they're all certified, so we use wood connectors on all these fixtures. Now, power delivery, I'm not going to talk too much about power delivery because it's the time is too short to cover all this, but there is another presentation coming along. So type C, so power delivery, so type C is then limited to 3 amps, 5 volts, so that's 15 watt. So in order to increase the power, the only way was to do that is actually increasing the voltage. So we'll have to increase the voltage steps, and there's a whole communication going over the CC line with BMC encoding. So in order to get this negotiation going, there's communication going between the source and saying, okay, say I can do this and that, and then actually the voltage steps can go up. The power is not only one going one way. I mean, let me take an example, a laptop. A laptop, you nowadays you charge over USB. So then it's a as a sink, but there can also be a source, because if you use that same port, it can also deliver 5 volt or even more. So then it's a DRP. So the direction of power is not straight as anymore as before. There are also active cables. Mentioned, if you want to go over 3 amps, you need to have actually EMARC cables. Otherwise, the thin wires, I mean, you have to make sure that the cable actually have big wires enough. So they need to be some kind of recognition in the cable in order to go over the 3 amps. So they have EMARC cable. Communication on alt mode is also actually done over the CC lines. So power delivery is actually more than only just power, but it's also doing another communication over these lines. Get this thing. So about power delivery, join us with the next webinar, and that is 10 June, and then we'll cover more on power delivery in that time frame, and then you can follow that. Now, I briefly wanted to go discuss also, I mean, Type-C had an additional test for radio interference. We briefly discuss this. So there is, if you Google this, I mean, there are a lot of problems with USB 3. So going from 5 gigabit to 10 and even the higher, there's some, because a lot of RF products, they work in a 2.4 gigahertz frequency range. There is some kind of disturbance coming from USB and actually drop in performance. Well, what we see is like, wireless mouse, for example, these small dongles, if they next to a USB 3 connector and you activate USB 3, the performance of the mouse drop or the Wi-Fi drop, because the five gigabit per second is actually 2.5 gigahertz disturbance, and typically the problems were related actually to the connector that inside, because it's not shielded enough. Now, Type-C improved a lot on this point, but the USB-IF actually had an additional test for this in order to cover all this. So to see that the final products are shielded enough and that these things are not disturbing any Wi-Fi or any other 2.4 gigahertz product. So, this additional test is only applicable for 5 gigabits or more, so USB 3.2 and higher. And what is this measurement? So we actually measure the noise floor, and it has to stay below this 100 dBm value. And this is done in a shielded box, and then we make sure with this fixture we actually test the product. So this is for final products only, not if you have an FPGA or whatever. There is a lot of disturbance going out, we know that, but if it's a final product and it's more than 3.2, then we actually need to perform these kind of testing. Quickly go over some, so we have discussed some USBF compliance, but yeah, USBF compliance, not forget there are some limitations to the program. I mean, it's tested under ideal conditions. Interoperability is only limited on a few. We test interoperability only on a few products. Safety is not covered. Thermal conditions are not covered. Cosmetic aspect, user experience, only cover a part of the specification, not everything. Power efficiency and these kind of things are not covered. We, of course, within Eurofins can cover this if needed. We can certainly help you on that. And make sure that if you test beyond compliance, as I said, some standards are more strict. You'll have to make sure that these things are covered as well. Do a lot of interoperability testing, electrical protocol, all these kind of things. You can do a lot, but many vendors are not compliant. So make sure that you do a lot of interoperability testing. This is actually the most important part, because you know, what these kind of things, with your customer, because there are a lot of products that are not certified, they not follow the rules, even very popular brands, they don't do any testing, or I mean, they assume that you follow the rules. I mean, you just want to make sure that Apple products work on your thing. But so do a lot of interoperability testing. And again, in Eurofins, we have a large testing pool, and we can help you with more interoperability testing. That's it from my side. I think we can go questions.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Pascal. Very interesting. We got a few questions in already, and I will ask everyone else if they have any questions. Then now is the time to ask them. Before we do, Remco, you might be able to show the sessions of the next sessions on the screen. Meanwhile, I also posted them in the chat as a link. I did it at the beginning of the session, so if you scroll up, then you would be able to find them if you want to register for that. Anyway, questions. We had a few. Let me start at the first one, which is basically about power delivery as well. Let me unmute my video, where the question related to a temperature rise inside the system and also in the connector, because everything is starting to get small and dense, of course. So what does 100 watt of power, or the announced 250 watts, 240 watts that we just announced by the certification standard, what will that do for heat up of connectors and cables? I'm not sure who can answer this best, but
I think I will take this up because it's more related to connector, I think, because that could be the hottest point, which you say, Alex, it's a dense version. If you're looking really to the end of the power delivery, so 100 watt, then the temperature rise would be around between 50 and 60 degrees Celsius. It's internally on the connector itself. So it will be going up so around, if you look into a lab environment, around 80 degrees at the end. So okay, sure. That's really, of course, pretty high, but for the industrial way, it's okay. So, and what Pascal already mentioned, the cable must go up to 100 degrees maximum on that way. So that could be a good environment.
Okay.
There are some guidelines in the Type C specification, actually, how to resolve some things of heat dissipation as well.
Yeah. Would it be possible to tell a little bit more about those guidelines, or?
The guidelines are, I'm not the thermal expert, but the guidelines are within the specification in Type C, so they're publicly, they're available there, and there are some tips on tricks how to work around this heat dissipation.
Okay, perfect.
Alex, a little bit in between, I want to share the links, but oh. I don't have the presenter rights.
Sorry, now you do. If everything's, yeah.
And now is everything black or not?
Yes.
Why is everything black?
No. Well, here it you is. Figure it out.
Yeah, will, yeah, here it is.
Then there was also a question that's also connector related, I guess. That was the question from the new extended power rating, I guess it means, is announced for the 240 watts that will allow to be transferred over the USB-C cables and connectors, of course. Will this be a limit for the current availability, the current connectors available on the market, and is that true for both the USB A and C connectors?
That's really a good question, because the 240 watts is a little bit different, of course, what you said. It's going instead of 20 volts up to 48 volts with the same amount of current. It's just introduced from my side, and our engineers, they are engineering the connectors, are still checking if it's going can be used like with the current USB-C or that it also must be an expanded version. Also, that is mentioned in USB IF, but it's really hard to check the right things. So they're really busy with it. So that's the only thing I can say. At this moment, yeah, we say there's a limit because in the data sheet, the 20 volts is mentioned, but maybe we can extend it and change that also in the future. But we are still okay. under investigation in this way.
So that's to be continued.
Yes, that's right.
Perfect. That is, I think, we'll get one more question. I wrote it down. One moment. Meanwhile, my son is in front of my house and he cannot get in, so I was a little bit distracted. But he has to wait. It's about the stack up, Remco. You showed the question is about if this will follow the specification regarding impedance matching, I guess.
I think then the people who is going to ask this, I think it's about 90 ohm, I think he is going to be the differential pair impedance. I'll have a look. I think it's about this slide. This is if you use this stack up and you look into this differential pair, you see the positive and negative side with this width of trace, the 230 micrometers from both sides, and the distance between this one with this stack up and all the FR4 materials in between, yeah, then we go on around 90 ohms impedance.
Okay.
This is really what we already also tested, and also the transfer of the data is on this way, on a good way, without any interference with the right chokes and that sort of things.
Perfect. Well, that's all the questions we got. I got one from Pascal myself. You showed, let me make you presenter. You showed and on your last slide, I think it was the one before, about the interference of Wi-Fi signals. Just a small remark that at our next session about power delivery, I want to look at that one a little bit as well, because we have designed a special call mode choke that especially focused on that particular problem for interference of high speed signaling coming from USB-C to wireless protocols. So that might be a nice little hook to the next session. I don't see any more questions going in, so that will leave me only to thank you all for one more. Sorry, let me read. I have to translate a little bit. Is it convincible that we can also change this? So the follow-up question about the extended power is that if there might be also need of a different authentication chip if you want to have this high power level. That's more software related, I guess.
And probably it will be a negotiation between the power delivery, I mean the source and the sync. They will have to make a negotiation like the power delivery is doing now. They say, okay, I have these capabilities, and then they have to go back and forward and then they will have the source will give the certain amount. Of course, both parties need to have a negotiation and to work.
Okay, perfect. Well, that's it for today. I will thank everyone for joining. I thank you guys for presenting. If there's any more questions, everyone knows as to how to find us. If there's still something unanswered, please let us know. We will upload this video to YouTube as promised, and well, I hopefully see you on June the 10th. Thank you.
All right.
Thanks. Bye. From my side. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.